Facebook. We're going to start out. If you have a hymnal, turn to hymn number 429. Those of you at home, you recognize it. It's Hark the Herald Angels Sing. And of course, we're going to do all four verses.
Fractured down.
For us to get together in His house around His word. I thank God that we're able to freely sing praises unto the Lord. And I count that as a blessing. All right. Yes, sir. we're getting into the praise or the prayer requests now. So we will pray that your mommy gets to feeling better. Unspoken prayer requests. Okay, most everyone. Let me go down my list, and then we'll take other prayer requests. Continue to pray for Sister Shirley Auten. Although the Ollieguds were able to be here back in church, we need to continue to pray for them. Stephen and Francine Chitty able to be back in church, but we need to continue to pray for them. Continue to pray for the Lutes, Brother Billy and Sister Vicky. I don't know how his test this week went, but need to continue to pray for him as well as his grandson and granddaughter. His granddaughter is due February?
I believe so, yes.
So be praying for her that her pregnancy will go well. And then continue to pray for Sister Garlene and her granddaughter, who is going to make her a great-grandmother, who her pregnancy is a high risk, and she is due in June. So we've got a good 7 months. We need to be praying for her. So we need to keep her before us. Shelly, Renee, everybody, please put her on your list. Mom and baby both will do well, and the delivery will go off without a hitch. All right. And then please continue to pray for Sister Fran Thompson. She's gotten over the COVID, but she's in rehab. So pray that her time there is short-lived. And then Betty Wilholt, also recovering from COVID. She is home now. She was released from the hospital. Please be praying for Sister Doris, that her back continues to improve, but then that her hip and her knee will also get better. And also, please be praying for Sister Sandra Mariah with her general health issues. All right. Please also be praying for my sister and her husband and their daughter. All three were tested positive for COVID. My sister and her husband live up in Tennessee. Their daughter is here in Pasco. She's a nurse. So please keep the three of them in your prayer. And then also, I have a cousin who is dealing with cancer. So please keep him in your prayers. All right. Other spoken requests. Yes, sir. Okay, that's right. Okay, others? Yes, ma'am.
For my friends that are expecting, and then for one of them who's pregnant with twins, that her husband would be able to get a job soon with everything going on.
Right, he lost his employment due to changes due to the COVID, so we need to be praying that he is able to find employment, especially with twins coming. That makes it a real necessity. All right, anybody else? Okay, we do need to be praying for those who are going to be traveling this time of year. A lot of folks are traveling. We also need to Dakota mentioned his mother, Vanessa, her foot, that it will continue to improve.
Oh, I forgot it. I'm sorry.
That's okay, buddy. I got it. I got you covered. All right. If that's all the prayer requests, then as far as announcements, remember service time, Sunday morning, Sunday school at 10, morning service 11, Sunday night at 6. And also, we are going to be having our anniversary Sunday. That will be the first Sunday in January 3rd. We are celebrating 25 years with Grace Baptist Church for the Carpenter family. And so we are excited about that. We've got a guest preacher coming in. We're going to have special music. And of course, good food to be had after the morning service. So be sure to, if you're local, we'd love to have you come and participate with us. All right, we're going to receive the offering. So we're going to pray for these requests and then pray for the offering. Our Heavenly Father, we truly are thankful for the opportunity that we have to be here and thankful that we're able to bring these requests to you. And we know that you are God who hears and answers prayer. And as we've thought about the number of people that were mentioned and represented, we ask that you would touch them according to your will. And we do pray for the spiritual needs, those that are backslidden, that you would work in their heart and help them to get right. Those that do not know you, that they would be receptive to your word. And Holy Spirit would be able to do the work needed, that they would come and accept you as their Lord and Savior. And Father, now we ask that you would bless this offering, that it would be used for the furtherance of the gospel. And we ask this in your precious and holy name. Amen.
One day he gave his life.
tonight, and I'm going to let you tell me where we're going to turn. We are, I think tonight, we are finally going to conclude our study on the Ten Commandments. So where do we find the Ten Commandments?
Exodus 20.
The book is Exodus, and Miss Beth went right to the punchline. Chapter 20. I was going to ask what chapter, but she stole that opportunity. All right. We started looking at the Ten Commandments several weeks ago, and due to illness and different things, we got interrupted, and we are actually on the Tenth Commandment, but we are going to review because it's been so long, and I know how forgetful some of you can be. All right, we start with the first commandment. We find it here in Exodus 20 and verse 3. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. It really is that simple. Now, when he says, thou shalt have no other gods before me, is he limiting that to idols or carvings or anything like that?
No.
No. What else could be a god that we put before him? Okay, some people can. But oftentimes, maybe our career.
Money.
Make sense.
Family.
Make sense.
Hobbies.
Mopping.
These are things that we can put ahead of God. Sometimes we do it deliberately, knowingly. Other times, we get caught up with whatever it may be that before we know it, we put that ahead of God. So, again, when he says, thou shalt have no other gods before me, he is not simply talking about worshiping something other than him as far as maybe we might think as a true God. But the way we live, right? Mm-hmm. We can live our life in such that something else can take first place. All right, verse 4, thou shalt make thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image or any likeness of anything that is in the heaven above or that is in the earth beneath or that is in the water underneath under the earth. All right, we're going to stop there and continue, but essentially says the same thing. We're not to create that idol of stone or wood or whatever it may be. Okay, the third is in verse 7. Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. Now, what does that word vain mean?
Empty,
right? And usually when we think of the third commandment, we think of people that use the Lord's name in profanity, right? I mean, that's the first thing I think of. But are there other ways that people take God's name in vain?
Yes, through prayer.
In prayer, right? And listen, I've been in a lot of churches, and I've been in a lot of churches where somebody is praying, and unfortunately, that is exactly what they do. I got to move over so I can see people. I can still reach my water. So when it talks about taking the Lord's name in vain, it isn't just profanity. Our Lord, when in Matthew chapter 6, when he is teaching us about prayer, one of the things he says is not to use vain repetition like the heathen do. He said, they think that we heard for their much speaking. And listen, I've been in churches where good
people do this. They don't set out to do it, but I think unfortunately it becomes habit. You know, if I was talking to Vanessa the way some people pray, it would sound ridiculous. Vanessa, the other day, Vanessa, I was going, Vanessa, down the street, Vanessa, 20th Street, Vanessa, and Vanessa, you should have seen this dog, Vanessa, that ran out in front of me, Vanessa. You know, if I have to use her name that much, we have a problem. If I have to call her by name that much because she's not listening to me, you know, that might be a conversation we don't need to have, right? And God, He knows who you're talking to. But we will do that. We will repeat Lord often, or one of my favorites, Father God, often. And unfortunately, it's filler, right? And that's not pleasing unto the Lord any more than when people use His name in profanity. Now that sounds, you know, what? Are you? Yes. He said, don't take His name in vain. And when we repeat His name like that, it's empty. It's just being used as filler. So that's something I try to be very careful of. And I got to be honest, there are times when I do it. And I do it to keep the cadence of the prayer while I'm thinking. Right? And so that's something we just need to be careful about. All right. Number four. Yes. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. Do we worship on the Sabbath?
No.
No, we do not. And so there are people out there that say, you're violating God's commandment. We worship not on the Sabbath, which is Saturday. Saturday is the Sabbath. We worship on Sunday, the first day of the week. And most Christians call it what?
Resurrection.
I love when I get different answers from it. What I was thinking, which y'all didn't pick up on, was the Lord's Day.
Oh,
of course. We worship on the Lord's Day because, and some people say Resurrection Sunday, which every Sunday is Resurrection Sunday. We are celebrating that Jesus Christ arose, and He did so on Sunday morning. And so that is why, that's one of the reasons we worship on Sunday. Also, we are told to bring our tithe unto the storehouse, first day of the week, and so forth. And so, now, the first four commandments deal with our relationship with whom?
God.
With God. The last six commandments deal with our relationship with?
100,000.
Others, right? Okay. So verse 5, excuse me, fifth commandment, verse 12 in Exodus chapter 20. Honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. All right. So honor thy father and thy mother. This is called the first commandment with promise, right? Because there's a promise there. If you honor your parents, then you're going to be blessed with long days. And when I was in banking, one of my fond memories is I had a customer. She was still driving herself to the bank. She would come in, go up to the tellers, and then she'd come over to my desk, and I would get up, and she would give me a hug. And every time she came in, even if I was working with clients, I would get up, and I would accept a hug from her. She was 102. And I told Beth, don't be upset with me for hugging this other lady, But she's 102, and I don't want to turn down a hug from a 102-year-old. And to look at her, I would have thought, you know, she was in her 80s, early 80s. She was still driving. She was, she you could sit down and have a conversation with her. You know, she was just 102, right? And I remember the first time I met her and the first time that I learned of her age, and she wasn't embarrassed of her age. You know, I don't think I would be either, right? And I told her, I made the comment to her something along the lines of, you know, it's a joy to meet somebody your age, because it's a testimony that you honored your mother and your father. And she said, well, of course I did. And you see, this is a commandment with a promise. What is it not saying that is equally true?
If you don't honor them, your life is not going to be long.
That's right. What we see here that it's not saying is the opposite. If you don't honor your father and your mother, then you do not have this promise of a long life. And the sad thing is, you can go to cemeteries and you can see the number of young people. Now, that doesn't mean that if you don't honor your parents, that you're not going to make it out of your teens or you're not going to make it out of your 20s. But it does say, excuse me, you don't have this promise of a long life, right? All right, now we're going to get to one that some people might have difficulty with. And verse 13, thou shalt not kill. Does that mean that as a Christian, I cannot serve in the military?
No.
I know not everybody in the military actually takes human life, but there was a shooting last night in Hillsborough County. Officer involved shooting. And the bad guy lost his life.
No.
Right? We hear about that. Does that mean that those officers who sometimes they have to shoot to defend themselves. Sometimes they have to shoot to stop somebody who is actively harming others. Does that mean that they violated the scripture?
No.
No.
Why not?
Law and order.
All right, law and order, but thou shalt not kill. Okay, I see everybody's talking it tonight. When we look at Scripture, do we see killings in the Scripture?
Yes.
Yes. What was the first homicide?
Cain and Abel.
Cain slew Abel. Right? And God dealt with him. Right?
Mm-hmm.
And then if we look at Scripture, do we ever find a time where God tells the children of Israel to kill?
Yes.
What? So, obviously, thou shalt not kill does not mean what a lot of people want it to mean, thou shalt not take a human life. Because there are times when God, in His Word, has commanded the children of Israel to go in to certain places and to annihilate everybody, right? To, as we might say today, to wipe it off the face of the earth. There's also, God tells us in His Word that if a man takes another human life, an innocent human life, that then by man shall his life be taken. That's where we get the principle for capital punishment. So when he says, thou shalt not kill, it is talking about the taking of innocent life. Now, in combat, in wars, our military, they have to take lives. So when we read this, we have to understand the biblical application. Any questions or comments? Of course not.
In that abortion.
Yeah. Again, thou shalt not kill is referencing the taking of innocent life, and there are none more innocent than a baby in the womb. And when we dealt with this commandment the first time, I stated it, and I'll state it now, abortion is homicide. Abortion is murder. I understand that there's some fellow running for some office in the Carolinas, somewhere up in there, that apparently used to be some kind of preacher, and he says that the Bible says it's okay for abortions. Well, I don't know what kind of perversion of God's word he is using, but I can tell you the taking of any innocent life is sinful. Now listen, let me say this. I also know that there have been women who have been forced to have an abortion. Now, somebody might be saying, how can you force somebody? Listen, there have been women who have been forced to have an abortion. And let me tell you, for those women, and for the women who nobody forced them, they went boldly and proudly and had an abortion, there is forgiveness. There is forgiveness. God will forgive. All you have to do is repent and seek forgiveness. All right, number seventh commandment, verse 14, thou shalt not commit adultery. All right, adultery. What is adultery? Okay.
Adultery is when someone has an affair.
Okay, adultery, Vanessa said, is when someone has an affair. To be a little bit more specific, adultery is when a married person has sexual relations of any kind, of any level, outside of marriage. Period. That's what adultery is. Whether you set it up with some online website, or it starts out as a quote-unquote innocent flirtation and builds, doesn't matter. If you are married and you have a sexual relationship with anybody other than your spouse, that's adultery. Why did that rate being one of the Ten Commandments?
Because marriage is one, the first union that Christ established, but then it's a picture of Christ and the church.
The first institution God created was marriage. God performed the first wedding ceremony. And God established the bond between a husband and wife. And as we look in the New Testament, we see that the marriage relationship is a picture of our relationship with Christ. And that's why it rates being mentioned. And God knows how dangerous sexual sin can be. And so I believe that that's the reason. All right, commandment number 8. Verse 15, thou shalt not steal. Anybody want to comment? No? Just Dakota and I, we're the only two wanting to talk.
Yeah.
I know Vanessa's been participating. Thou shalt not steal. Everybody knows what is stealing. Stealing is taking something that doesn't belong to you. Right? And everybody knows stealing is wrong. That's just something I believe we're all born with. That's why as a little kid who wants to take a piece of candy from the store, he hides it. I'm not going to ask for a show of hands of how many of you stole candy when you were a kid, because I don't think anybody would raise their hand regardless. But that is stealing, right, in the simplest mm-hmm. definition.
Yes.
But that's not the only way people steal, especially nowadays, right?
So?
I remember this day, I was, for just a little bit, I was flattered I had my identity stolen. I said, somebody wants to be me. And when I was in banking, I helped a lot of people who are victims of identity theft, right? And so in the computer age in which we live, thefts happen all the time. You know, the number of clients I had that would come in because their account got compromised. And they didn't know how it happened. And most of the time, it was through something the client did. Right? That's theft. That's theft. Stealing somebody else's ideas mm-hmm. is theft. Right? All right. Now, number 9. Verse 16. Thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor. This is another one we talked a little bit in length about. Thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor. Does that say thou shalt not lie?
No.
What? It doesn't.
No.
So lying's okay?
Sometimes.
What?
Sometimes. Wow. Right?
My answer changed from when we actually went over this.
If you're talking to your child and you're teaching your child, we do not lie, and somehow it comes out, is it okay to lie sometimes? And they say, yes. Don't chastise them because they're right. Right? And all we have to do is look at God's word. And the big example, and the reason why thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor doesn't equate to thou shalt not tell a falsehood, right? That's a lie. Is when the spies went into Canaan. And they were hidden by a harlot of all people. She took them in, and the authority showed up. So, where are those spies? She said, I don't know, they left. Right? They were here 1 minute. Turn around, they're gone. Sneaky people. And the authority said, thank you, and went their way. And then she said, listen, I hid you guys. I saved your lives. You need to save mine. Right? And so The spies made a deal with her. When we conquer the city, you throw this red cord out your window, and everybody that's inside this house will be saved. If your brother's running out in the street for some reason, his blood's on him. But everybody inside your house will be saved. Was that not a lie?
Yes.
Did she not lie to the authorities? But she did so to save their lives and ultimately save her family's lives. So, thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor. You know, when I read that, and I'm not trying to dissect these, right? But when I read that, thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor, makes me think that if you're bearing false witness against your neighbor, there's malice involved, right? Oh, it's okay to lie as long as nobody gets hurt, right? There comes a time, and an example that we used closer in history were the people that hid the Jews during the Holocaust. Was that not? Well, we know it was unlawful. And when the authorities came to their house, where are the Jews? There are no Jews here. And they searched and they couldn't find them. That was not telling the truth. All right, so I'm not saying it's okay to go out and lie all the time, but we have to put it in perspective. Okay. All right, we're going to get the one we've been waiting on. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's house, thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's wife, nor his manservant, nor his maidservant, nor his ox, nor his ass, nor anything that is thy neighbor's. Why?
Because then we're not thankful for what we have.
Then we're not thankful for what we have. You know what? And this is just the way my mind works. And it's no coincidence that it's the 10th commandment. If you covet, you're going to start breaking the other commandments. We saw this with David, King David, remember? He coveted Bathsheba. And what happened? He committed adultery, right? So there went the 7th commandment. He violated the 6th commandment when he had Uriah killed, right? I would say he violated the 8th commandment because after he had him killed, he ended up taking everything, right?
So, and he was planning on violating the 9th commandment.
Yeah.
Because he was planning on setting him up.
Yes, he was.
Or he was trying to.
And so, coveting, what action is involved? What physical action is involved in coveting?
Your eyes? Your heart, thinking.
Okay.
Your thought process.
So, everything that y'all are saying is correct, but none of it's really physical. Right? To kill somebody, I'm going to do something physical. To bear false witness, I'm going to flap my gums. Right? To steal, I'm going to take something. Coveting. I can be sitting here in front of a stadium full of people. All right, so it wouldn't actually be here. I could be in front of a stadium full of people and covet, and nobody would know. See, that's how dangerous coveting is. You know, and some might say there's a fine line between appreciating and coveting. Right? I love old trucks. And I'll see them drive by and I'm like, oh, wow, check that out. Right? Almost break my neck trying to look at it and take it all in. But let's say my neighbor had one of those fine trucks, and actually what somebody in our neighborhood did, and I saw it, and every day I'm like, I want that truck. You go from saying, wow, that's a nice truck, I like that truck, to I want that truck, I'm going to have that truck. And then if you're not careful, you're going to be close, or you may even do these other things, right? And I used a truck. With King David, it was a woman.
Well, I also think about it for some in the workplace. You can covet a position, you know, or a promotion or something, and then bear false witness against maybe somebody else who's lined up for that promotion. You know, something like that.
So it's not just about physical possessions. Your analogy of a position, that's a great analogy.
Even in relationships, when there's competition in relationships.
Yes, mm-hmm. Yeah. And so, although it was the last, I think it can be one of the most dangerous commandments for us to violate. Because seriously, all these others, you could covet something, again, a possession or a position, and make it a god.
Mm-hmm.
Right? I did that. I regretted it. So, when we think about these Ten Commandments, and unfortunately, there are some people that think that they're saved by keeping the Ten Commandments. And the Bible does not teach that. And one thing we have to remember, the Ten Commandments are simply a synopsis of God's commandments. If you were able to be saved by keeping God's law, there are hundreds of laws you would have to keep. And the Bible says that if you violate one, you're guilty of violating them all. We are taught that God gave us the law not for us to keep to be saved, but the law is our schoolmaster, and schoolmasters teach. What does the law teach us? That we're sinners. Right? That we can't keep the law. It teaches us that we are sinners in need of a Savior. And Jesus Christ, who this month a lot of people are thinking about, except they're thinking about the baby Jesus. A lot of them don't want to talk to you about the adult Jesus, who tells you that you need to be born again. But that's what the commandments are for. Does that mean, I know I'm a sinner, so I don't need to follow the Ten Commandments? A lot of people don't like this, but in the United States of America, our legal system was founded on the commandments. That's why a lot of courtrooms, the commandments were on display. And a lot of people say, oh, I don't like those up there. Why do you think telling people thou shalt not steal is a bad thing? Thou shalt not kill is a bad thing? Right? So, keep in mind, you know, some people say, well, we are in the dispensation of grace, and that's the law, so we no longer need to follow the law. When I run into folks who tell me that, they say, we don't need to follow the law. So No, you can't get. Why?
It's the law.
It's illegal.
It's the law.
But it wouldn't be illegal if it wasn't for this. And you say we no longer have to follow this. And you annoy me tremendously, so can I kill you? No. No, we need to honor our parents. We need to not kill, not commit adultery, not steal, not bear false witness. And we certainly don't need to covet. All right, that concludes our series on the Ten Commandments. There were only 10, and we were able to make it last 20 weeks. So, we're going to be dismissed in a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, again, we thank you that we've been able to gather together and to open your word, and we've been able to read from it, we've been able to discuss it, we've been able to learn from it. Now, Lord, I do ask that you'd help us to hide your word in our heart that we might not sin against you. As we leave here, I ask that you dismiss us with your blessing, bring us back again at the appointed hour, and we ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.